You guys got your Bibles? Get a hold of them. Come on, stand to your feet. I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, we thank you, Lord, that in your presence, there is the joy of the Holy Spirit, God. And today we come into your house, Lord. We celebrate, Lord. We're so honored, God, and blessed that we can come into your house openly, freely, God. We say thank you to Jesus for our freedom, first and foremost, for him laying down his life for us. And God, we also thank you for those who are brave enough to do the same and follow our Lord Jesus Christ. The run to the battles, God, bless all of our armed forces, all of our policemen, all of our firefighters, God, all the military, God, and those who have given the sacrifice and let their loved ones go. Father, some of them have not received them back, but God, we thank you, Lord, that our future is secure in you. We thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ. Today, as we come into your house and open up your word together, God, we pray that you would open it up to us. Truly, today we did not come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We came to hear from you. Welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And we'll say thank you for it, Lord. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. God, today also we would ask for the nations, God, as Pastor Luke's in the Philippines, Lord, and as we're sending teams to Peru this week, God, Pastor Joe and Dr. Paul and Beth and others are going to be going, the youth and the young adults, as they travel, God. You bless them, that you protect them, God, and may they have a fruitful ministry there in the different areas to the uttermost ends of the earth where they're traveling, God. And Lord, we praise you and thank you for that. God, also, we would ask, Lord, that you don't just bless us, but bless all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel. They're our brothers and sisters. Lord, we ask that you bless them as you bless us. And additionally, that God, that we pray a special prayer for the persecuted church, God, that you would protect them, guide them, deliver them, Lord. May they endure to the end. Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Well, today, get your Bibles out and go with me to the book of Leviticus. Leviticus, we're going to be in the last chapter of Leviticus, so if you want to start in Genesis, find Exodus, Leviticus, find Numbers, and then just back up a couple pages into Leviticus, the 27th chapter. We're going to be taking a look at one verse. This is breathing room, part number 3, and today we're talking about establishing the tithe. There was a man who was traveling. He was in an airport. As he was traveling, he got hungry. It was morning time for his body, and so he decided he was going to go find some breakfast. Went out and found a little donut shop and bought himself a bag of donuts, a little cup of coffee, and went to go find a place to sit down and eat his breakfast. Now, the airport was packed. People were everywhere. He couldn't find a spot anywhere, and so he's searching around, and finally, off in the distance, he spots a table where there's one guy sitting on one end, and there was no one sitting on the other end. So you know the rules of the jungle. If there's an open seat, I'm going to go sit down, right? And so he decided, he headed over there and found that seat. He put all of his bags down on the ground, put his coffee down on the table, took his coat off, hung it over the chair, sat down, and kind of got himself situated, opened up the bag of donuts right there in front of him, pulled out a donut, took his coffee, got a little sip of his coffee, and started to eat one of his donuts. After a moment, the guy sitting across the table from him looked up, reached over into the bag of donuts, grabbed one of the donuts out, smiled at the man, and took a bite. Now, the man was shocked. He couldn't believe what he was seeing. I mean, what does the world come to when people just start stealing your donuts? I didn't invite him to have one of my donuts. I mean, I'm just sitting here minding my own business, and this is just crazy. Now, he didn't want to say anything to the guy because he didn't know if he was dealing with a full deck. You know what I'm saying? He didn't know if the elevator went all the way to the top. So he decided that rather than say anything and maybe it gets violent, that he would just give him one of those, if looks could kill looks, right? And he let him know non-verbally how he felt. So after a moment, the man reaches over and he grabs the bag of donuts and he pulls them all the way over to his side of the table, as far away from the other man as he could. He reaches in, pulls out a donut, and starts to eat his donut. After a moment, the man across the table from him finished his donut, so he reaches his arm all the way across the table, grabs the bag of donuts, pulls it over to his side, reaches inside, pulls out a donut, takes a bite, and then pushes the bag back across the table to the man and smiles at him. Now the man is thinking, this is getting crazy. This is out of hand. I can't believe what I'm seeing here. This guy is a donut thief. Who does he think he is? He can just steal donuts like that. Now, the other man across the table looks at his watch. He realizes it's time for his plane. He stands up. He throws his coat on. He walks over next to the man. He reaches down one more time. There's one donut left in the bag. He pulls the donut out of the bag, breaks it in half, puts half the donut back into the bag, puts half the donut into his mouth, smiles at the man, gives him a little wave, and walks off to go catch his flight. Now, the man is just beside himself once again. He can't believe what he's seeing. He's thinking to himself, I'm not eating that donut, you donut thief. You're probably all full of germs, all full of infection, and there's no way I'm eating that donut. So he looks at his watch. He realizes it's his time for his flight, and so he pops up, throws his jacket on, takes his coffee and the bag of donuts with a half a donut in it, throws it in the trash, goes over back to his table where his bags are. He reaches down to pick up his bags off the ground, and there on top of his bags is his bag of donuts. See, the other man wasn't stealing his donuts. He was sharing his donuts. Now, the principle for all of us today in talking about establishing the tithe. Are you guys ready for this? Here's the principle. God owns all the donuts. You all need to get a hold of this, so I'm going to make you say this with me, okay? Ready? One, two, three, here we go. God owns all the donuts. When you leave here, I got to know that you know this, so let's say it again. God owns all the donuts. Let's take a look at it in the Word of God. Leviticus, the 27th chapter, verse number 30. Take a look at what it says with me. In Leviticus, the 27th chapter, verse number 30, it says, and all, everybody say all. How many? All, and all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. We need to understand that everything that we have, everything that we ever will have, anything that we can see, everything that surrounds us, God created it all. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the Bible tells us. God is the owner of the cattle on 1,000 hills. God is the one who owns the heavens and the earth. He is the creator of all things. Therefore, all things are His. From Him and through Him and to Him are all things. Therefore, God owns all the donuts. And God is not stealing from us when He asks us to bring our tithes and our offerings into the storehouse of God. God is rather sharing what He already possesses with us. And now we as stewards are to bring our tithe because God, look at all the tithe of the land. How much is all? All. You guys got that one right. All of the tithe. All of it belongs to the Lord. It's the Lord's. It's holy to the Lord. It's dedicated and devoted to God. When we talk about establishing the tithe, sometimes people get off on this. First things first, we have to find out what is a tithe, because we don't use that word outside of church, right? Really, the tithe is just a simple word that means a tenth. Okay, a tenth. So a tithe, what is it? A tithe is a tenth. You take 10% right off the top and you give that to God. That is what is a tithe. Now, okay, just to bring this point home, you cannot tithe 5%. Why? Because tenth means 10%, right? So you cannot tithe. That's half a tithe, right? That's half a tenth if you're tithing 5%. And additionally, on the opposite scale, you cannot tithe 12% because that's a tenth. That's a tithe and an offering, and I would encourage you to do that because you will be blessed, and the Lord loves a cheerful giver. That's okay. But if you're saying, I'm working up to tithing 10%, so I'm tithing 5%, no, you're not. You're tithing a half of a tithe at that moment. Everybody got that? I know, it's math, it's hard, we shouldn't be doing that in church. We should be talking about spiritual things. And yet, here we find in the Word that a tithe is 10% of your income. 10% of your gross wage, profit, or increase. See, sometimes we get this, we say, well, no, I don't get the gross amount. I only get the net amount after the government's taken their part out and healthcare costs and Social Security and all that kind of other stuff. Well, listen, how many of the donuts belong to God? All the donuts belong to God, isn't that right? So therefore, everything that you have, God has given to you anyways. And before anyone else takes their share out of that, who should be first? God. And so God says, every time you get paid, you get a bag of 10 donuts. And God says, I want you to take one of those donuts and I want you to bring it to the local church where you're attending. Now, that's it. That's the simple principle of tithing. You take a tenth right off the top and you bring it to the Lord's house. So here we are. We have 10 donuts. We bring one of those to the church. Now we have 9 donuts left over. The problem is maybe you're like me. You've got 9 donuts and you need 11. Hello? And so what do? We decide, you know what, I need 11, and if I tithe, I won't have enough. But I think the problem is many Americans have not yet heard the sermon on the amount. We've got a lot of Christians who are so tight, they're squeezing the dollar so tight, George Washington is rolling over in his grave. And God is saying, I own all the donuts. I want you to take that. I give you, every time you get paid, you get a bag with 10 donuts. And I want you to take one of those donuts, bring it to the local church where you're getting fed from, where you're attending. And then I'm going to take those 9 donuts and it will satisfy whatever your hunger is. Hello. Now, see, I don't know how God does that. But that's a supernatural blessing and power of God. And we're going to take a look today at how this works and what tithing really does for our lives. Malachi, the 3rd chapter. Turn there with me. Malachi, the 3rd chapter. If you find Matthew in the New Testament, just turn a couple pages back. You'll find Malachi, last book of the Old Testament. And the 3rd chapter, probably the most famous verses when it comes to tithing. Malachi, the 3rd chapter, verse number 8, says this. It says, will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and in offerings. In other words, we've been stealing God's donuts. All this time we thought God was stealing our donuts. No, we're the thieves. We're the ones who have been taking what is God's. Verse number 9, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. So we see the position that we put ourselves in when we withhold that which is God's. God gives us the solution in verse number 10. Look at what it says. It says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse. The storehouse is the place where you're getting fed from. He says, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. So right there in verse number 10, we find something out. Not only what is a tithe, tithe is 10%, but where does the tithe go? The tithe belongs to the storehouse. God says, my house. Now we know from the Bible that the house of God is the church of God. It is the storehouse. It's the place where you're coming and where you're getting fed from. It's the place where you're sitting and enjoying the AC. It's the place where when you flush a toilet, that water was paid for by the local storehouse. When you're wiping your hands after you wash them, after you use it, that's what I meant to say, hands, all right? And that paper costs money. Costs money for the outreaches. Costs money for the gospel to go forth into the nations. Costs money for all those things. So that's why we bring our tithes. See, sometimes we get this wrong. We think, well, wait a second, you know, I'm receiving spiritual food from the televangelists, and I really am getting blessed by their ministry on the TV, and so I want to send my tithe to the televangelists. No, that is not the storehouse. That may be a worthy ministry, and that's okay to send an offering to somebody. Yeah, if you got those 9 donuts and you say, you know what, I'm really blessed by them, I want to break off a little piece of this one and send it over to that ministry, that's great. I would encourage you that if you're receiving, yeah, share every good thing with your teacher. That's cool, but the tithe belongs to the storehouse, the local church where you're getting fed from. Now, sometimes people say, well, okay, I got that, but you know what? My kids, they're getting fed over there at the Christian school, you know, and that's where they're getting educated, and so I need to pay for their education to have them in a godly upbringing. No, that's called tuition. And you, as a family, are coming to the storehouse where spiritually there's a covering and there's an anointing that you're getting fed from. And this is the place where, now if you want to break off a little piece of that donut and say, hey, I like what you guys are doing with my kids, and here's some little extra for supplies or for the playgrounds or what, that's cool. And again, I would encourage you to do that. Sometimes people say, well, you know, God's really into people. And when I see people and their needs, you know, what I do is I set aside 10% of my income and I just have a God account that whenever God wants it and he leads me, I'll take that tithe and I'll use it to bless other people. And I'll bless my neighbors or my family members that are in need. Or if I see someone on the street that's down on their luck, I'll use my tithe for them. No, no, no. That's called good works. And that is called almsgiving. And the Bible does encourage that as well. Because the Bible tells us that he who gives to the poor lends to the Lord, and the Lord himself shall repay. So you're never going to lose by being generous with somebody. But that is not a tithe. Tithing is 10% right off the top, brought to where? The storehouse. It's the church, the place where you are getting fed from. Are you guys listening? Amen? Or oh me? Amen. Amen. Bring the tithe into the storehouse. So what does tithing do? God knows that we need incentive. He needs to know that he understands how he built us, how he made us. And if we know what tithing does, then we are more apt to do it. So a couple of things that I want to take a look at today about what tithing does. First thing is this, is that tithing delivers us from financial fear under the spirit of mammon. Tithing delivers us from financial fear under the spirit of mammon. Now, you're going to experience this if you've never tithed before. I mean, if you have tithed, you know what takes place. Here you are, you've got 10 donuts. God says, I want you to bring one of those donuts into the church where you're getting fed from, and I want you to give that as your tithe. Then I will bless the other 9 donuts to spend like whatever you have need of. And as you bring your tithe into the storehouse of God, you give it there in the storehouse of God, and what happens? The spirit of mammon rises up and tells you, if you give that money away, you have now diminished your purchasing power. Is that right? Because now you no longer have the 100%, you now have 90%, but your need exceeds the 100%. You're at 110% need, right? And so the spirit of mammon will try and drive us into fear. You shouldn't give that because you're already not going to make it to the need. Therefore, if you give this amount, you're going to diminish your purchasing power. But remember that we are no longer under the systems of this world. We are no longer attached to the spirit of mammon. When we give with no expectation of return, what do? We introduce our finances to the grace of God. Now we've broken the spirit of mammon off of our finances. We're delivered from that fear. And now we are operating in the spirit of God rests on our finances. And we're operating in God's system of giving and receiving. Okay? Now track with me on this for a second. So, yes, in the natural, we could calculate that my purchasing power has been diminished. But what has not been diminished is the kingdom of God that as I give without any expectation of receiving, now God's grace is upon me, and I have not diminished my ability to receive everything that I have need of. Are you listening? See, that's good news, because I don't need purchasing, giving in kind for the exact amount. I give you this amount and return in the value. That's buying and selling. But rather, I can give without any expectation of return, and then it doesn't matter what the need is, doesn't matter how small or how great the need is, I have the ability, by the grace of God, to receive all that I have need of. We saw this in Malachi, the 3rd chapter, verse number 10. What did God say? He said, bring all the tithes in the storehouse of God, that there may be food in my house, and will I not open the windows of heaven and pour out on you such a blessing that you will not have room enough to receive it? You won't even be able to contain it. You know what that is? That's an overflowing blessing, and that is not giving in the same amount and returning in the same amount. That's giving in a certain amount and receiving so much more. Amen? See, tithing makes the statement that God is my source. And mammon has no power in my life. If you want to break out from the world system and get out from underneath the bondage of the enemy, the devil, then it's time to take that first step of faith. And as you tithe, you're saying, I am not looking to money as my source. I'm looking to God as my source. Now that brings us to the next thing for today is what tithing is not. Okay? What tithing is not. Tithing is not the answer to all of your financial problems. Maybe you've heard in churches or you've gotten this impression from how tithing was presented that if I just start tithing, it'll just take care of all of my financial problems and they will just magically disappear. That's not the case. Because the moment you start tithing and the moment you break that spirit of mammon off your finances, yes, you'll be under the grace of God. But at the same time, how many of you know the devil gets mad when we get blessed? And therefore, all hell is going to break loose against you financially. Okay? But now you're no longer under that system. You're no longer under that spirit. You're under the spirit of God and the spirit of grace now. And so you don't have to fear, but there still will be trouble. There still will be trials. Additionally, you could give that tithe to the church and then be a bad money manager on the back end and still have financial problems. So tithing is not your solution. God is your solution. Tithing is not your source. This is not a religious expression. This is not a religious system that we do this and then we get this and that's all that there is with no heart, no love behind it. No, tithing is out of obedience because God is my source. I love the Lord. I'm going to walk in obedience to his commands, and God is the one who is the answer to all of my financial problems. So what does tithing do? Number one, tithing delivers us from financial fear under the spirit of mammon. Second thing that we see that tithing does is tithing shows the priority that God is first. Tithing shows the priority in our lives that God is first. Proverbs chapter 3, turn there with me. Right after the Psalms, you'll find the book of Proverbs chapter number 3. And in Proverbs chapter 3, we're going to take a look at a couple of verses. Verse number 9 and verse number 10. Proverbs chapter 3, starting out in verse number 9, says this. It says, honor the Lord. Everybody say honor.
Honor.
Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. Now, that answers the question of when. When do I tithe? See, sometimes we get off of this and we think, well, is it every month, every year? When do I tithe? What do I do? How do I do that? Okay. What does he say? The first fruits. Right off the bat. See, that's why we say it's on the gross amount and not on the net amount. Because if it was on the net amount, that's not the first. The government was first. Social Security was first. Healthcare was first. No, God needs to be the priority. God is first in all things. He is the preeminent one. He is the exalted one. He was before all things. He's the creator of all things. He is the Alpha. God is worthy of being first in every area of our lives, and especially over unrighteous money and mammon. Therefore, bring all the tithes. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. Now, remember, verse number 10 comes along, and look at what it says. So your barns will be filled with plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine. See, when we put God as a priority, stuff is not an issue any longer. We've broken off of the spirit of mammon of buying and selling, and now we are in giving and receiving. And now, remember Malachi, the third chapter, God was saying, so that my house there may be food. But now when we honor the Lord, we see that God is first, therefore God will take care of the rest. And now he points the finger back at us and he says, your barns, that's that overflowing, opening the windows of heaven and pouring out a blessing on us, so much so that we can't contain it. Your barns will be filled with plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine. My wife, who's over here on the front row, and I, when we went to Bible college, there was a time where we were in a financial class. And, you know, a couple of starving college students, here we are, we're eating top ramen every day because, you know, you could get 10 of those for a dollar. And so we actually thought about making a cookbook until we saw someone already did it, but it was like the 1,001 ways to prepare top ramen. We had that down, you know what I mean? And we were working on the 2000, 1002, 1003, because every day it was just, that was cheap food. And some of you guys know what I'm talking about. We were working at one of those big box warehouse stores, and we were paying bills and doing what we could. And somehow, you know, we always, tithing was never an issue for us. Both of us grew up, and we were raised in the ways of the Lord. And so, therefore, we always tithe. But additionally, during that time, this church was being built. And so we were tithing to the local church at that time that we were attending, because we were getting fed at that storehouse at that time. But we were sending a building fund back to this church to help build this building that we're enjoying today. And when we got married, she had a certain amount that she had pledged. And I said, well, let's double that amount, because now there's two of us. We can do that easily. She kind of freaked out, like, whoa. And I was like, nah, we got this. God's got this. And so we were being faithful. We were doing it all. And after bills and everything, we had probably like $20 left over in the account. And you know, a couple of young newlyweds, you know, we made that work. It was like, we're going on a date today, honey. No, not just any date. We're going on a good date. I'm going to take you to El Taco, and we're going to get the Supreme. not the dollar menu. No, I'm going to get you the Supreme with the sour cream and cheese. And then we're going to a dollar movie. We're finally going to see that movie everybody's been talking about. Okay, honey? Got you. Love you. That's just how we lived, and we loved it. You know, we go out and get one ice cream. Why? Because we were in love. I'll lick this side, you lick that side. You know? Lady and the Tramp eating spaghetti and meat in the middle. That, I mean, that was our life, you know, but only it was top ramen. It wasn't, I don't know, anyways. So we had a budgeting class. We had a finance class. And part of the assignments that we were given in that finance class was that we had to write down our budget. We had to go and sit down and write down a budget. So we went home that week and we pulled out a blank sheet of paper. We wrote our income at the top, expenses all the way down, made sure here's our building fund, here's our tithe, you know, and then we drew a line. We subtracted all the numbers from the income and the expenses, and then down at the bottom we found that there was a negative number. How many know we're in trouble when we got negative numbers on our budget, right? And so we're confused. We're thinking, this can't be right. You know, there's something wrong here. And so we got the $20 every month left over. So we ripped all that up. We threw that in the trash. We said, we must have done something wrong. So we pulled out a brand new clean sheet of paper, wrote our income at the top. Then we wrote out all of our expenses, made sure building fund. We don't want to forget the tithe. Tithe is in there. Tithe is important. You know, tithe is priority for our life. We wrote that and we drew the line down there, subtracted it all down. And we came up with a different number this time. It was less, even greater negative number. I'm thinking, this is crazy. What are we doing? But then we started to praise God because we thought, well, if that's the case, we're coming up with negative numbers and we still have $20 left over, God's just blessing us. And that's God's math, and praise the Lord, right? But something was still wrong in our hearts, and we said, God, what's going on here? I mean, we know that you're doing something supernatural. We know that you're taking care of our financial needs, and we know that we should not be making it, but we're making it because we're in your system, right? We're receiving more than we're given, and then it's going out. And so we're not under the spirit of mammon over here. We're under the spirit of grace and giving and receiving. But God, something's wrong here. And God said, take a look at your budget. So we took a look, and we said, yeah. He said, look at your expenses there. We said, yeah. He says, look at the tithe. And we said, yeah, God, it's right there. He said, yeah, look at it again. Yeah, God, right there. Yeah. Yeah, look at it. Uh-huh, God, right there. Lord, are we talking on the same thing here, God? You know, kind of like, what's going on here? God says, where is the tithe? We said, well, Lord, it's right there down at the bottom of the list. God says, move that up to the top and see what happens. So we were excited now, right? We shredded the paper, threw it in the trash, got out a brand new blank sheet of paper, wrote our income there, and then right on the income, first thing, priority number one, our God is priority number one. We wrote the tithe right there at the top. Then we put all of our expenses, made sure we had building fund in there, okay? And we drew this big line across the bottom, and this time when we subtracted it, we came up with an even greater negative number. Must have forgot a bill in there somehow. I don't know what happened. But we had to throw our hands up in the air and just laugh and say, okay, God, we did what you said. And then we were diligent about it afterwards. When we were sitting down writing checks to all the different utilities and the companies and all that kind of stuff, first things first, we were on each other. Hey, first check is the Lord's. You better not write any other check until we write the tithe check. That's the first thing that's coming out. And so we were diligent about it. We were diligent to bring it to the house of God. Now, okay, think about it this way. Oh, I got to tell you the rest of the story. Right? So we continued on because God said, watch what happens. We didn't have $20 left over after we made that change. We had hundreds of dollars left over after making that change. I was like, ooh, girl, we are skipping Del Taco. We're going to go to the Macaroni Grill. Hallelujah. Praise God. Starving college students, man, we were eating like kings at that place. Saving the doggy bag afterwards, too. But if I had $10, let's say you just got paid. You got that bag of donuts, right? Let's change donuts to dollars for a second. I've got $10, and I had them all in crisp, clean $1 bills, and I laid those out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Which one of those is the tithe? The first one? Is that the one over here? Oh, over here, right? It's the first one over here that I laid out? What if I shuffled them up? Is it still that one? Is it still the one over here? Or was it the first one that I laid out? See, how do you determine which dollar is the first portion or is the tithe? Here's how. Whatever you spend first is the tithe. In other words, that's the reason why, once again, we go back to if the government's taking this portion out, no, you go off the gross amount. Even though that might be automatic, that first portion that you spend, that first portion that you give. You ever wonder why we have six different ways to give at this church? Here's the reason why, is because we know that in your heart, you want to put God first. And therefore, if you get that notification on your phone from your bank that there has been a deposit in your account, then you can go to our app, you can text to give, you can go online. Some of you guys got automatic clearinghouse where you don't even have to think about it. It's just like the government, God gets his share automatically and you just know it's going there. That's why with a check, you can write it out, or if you want to take an envelope home so that when you're sitting there doing your bills, the first thing that you write down is your tithe. That's why we have all the bajillion different ways to give, is because we know that you want to honor the Lord first. And technology and the way today is allows us to do that first and foremost. It's a priority in our lives. I was so pleased. I was sitting with Adam. Adam's right over here. He's now the chief financial guy here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center starting June 1st. We're making a transition in the ministry. Adam's just doing a bang-up job. Wave it, everybody, Adam. Man, I know you hate this. Wave it, everybody. Adam is like the introvert of all introverts. But anyways, he's the man for the job. And so we were sitting there having the financial report, and we realized, man, we're not, you know, quite getting what we normally would get. And every week he started telling us, well, no, that's not all the giving yet. You got to wait for the online and the texting and all that kind of stuff because people are using it. And the neat thing for me was when he told me people are giving online and through text 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. You know what that shows? That shows that this church has a heart for the Lord, and you guys are putting a priority not on your money, but on God. That's awesome. That's awesome. So, tithing shows the priority of where God is in our life. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, should we even be tithing at all? I mean, like, isn't that a part of the Old Testament law? Well, yeah, it is. You can find that in the Old Covenant. You can find that in the Old Testament law. In fact, the book of Leviticus that we read, that was after Moses came and instituted the law, where it says that the tithe belongs to the Lord. But did you know that tithing predates the law, predates the Mosaic Covenant by 430 years? See, tithing is not something that God instituted at the law. Tithing is something that Abraham did by faith before the law ever existed. And therefore, when Jesus comes along thousands of years later and he says, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works that he did, we need to understand that he's not just talking about faith, he's talking about the works that Abraham did. What did Abraham do? By faith, Abraham, after he had received increase from a great battle, brought the tithe and gave it to the representative of God at that time, Melchizedek. Now, we understand from the New Testament in Hebrews, the 7th chapter, that Melchizedek, meaning King of Righteousness and also the King of Salem, or the King of Peace, is a type of Jesus Christ. And therefore, we understand that here, Abraham tithed and gave it to the representative of God at that time. In the same way, we, by faith, bring our tithes and our offerings in the storehouse of God and give it to the representative that's there at that time. But Jesus himself receives them unto the Lord. See, Jesus is the representative of God. He is now our King. And when you bring your tithes, it's not an Old Testament law type of a thing. See, we think of tithing as a directive rather than a descriptive. Okay, what do I mean by that, a directive? People think of it this way, tither, you'll be cursed, right? That's a directive. It's almost like what your parents used to tell you growing up, right? They told you, you can't wear white after Labor Day. You guys, anybody remember that? Don't wear white after Labor Day, and you never knew why growing up. You went and your parents would tell you, go get dressed for church. You'd come out after Labor Day in your nice white shirt, or girls, you had the white dress. And they said, oh, honey, no, let's put this away. It's after Labor Day. And you thought in your mind as a child, like, oh, if I went out in white after Labor Day, was a lightning bolt going to zap me from the sky? Or were people just going to shun me? Oh, they're wearing white after Labor Day, unclean, right? And they're going to... So you never knew what the deal was, right? But then you grew up and you got out on your own. And you were doing life by yourself, and maybe you forgot to do laundry, and there you went after Labor Day, and you opened up your closet, and there wasn't nothing clean but the nice white shirt, or the nice white dress, or the white pants, right? And so you went back to the dirty laundry, and you smelled it all to see if you could wear it again, but it wasn't clean enough, so you had to go take the white pants out of the closet, and with much fear and trembling, you put them on leg by leg, wondering if they were going to burn as you put them on, and they didn't. And then you stepped outside of the front door and you looked to the skies. And there wasn't a single lightning bolt that came out. Got to work that day and somebody gave you a compliment. They weren't shunning you. They were saying, hey, you're looking pretty dapper in your white. You're pretty smart to wear white after Labor Day when it's so hot here in Southern California. And you all of a sudden went from fear to now, well, what were my parents thinking? That's a stupid old rule. I wonder why that even came up. See, we think of tithing as that, tither be cursed, right? And maybe at one time you were raised that way, or you started tithing, then you got off of it, and no lightning bolts came out of the sky, and, you know, no one shunned you, no one seemed to care about it. But you were wondering, well, then what's the point? Isn't that just old? Isn't that antiquated? Do I even need that? See, tithing is not a directive. Tithing is a descriptive. Let's switch over to what a descriptive is for a moment. The law of gravity, right? What goes up must come down. Okay, we hopefully all should know that. Hopefully you guys know that. Okay? But in the law of gravity, if I said to you that there's a cliff over there, and if you walk in that direction long enough and you keep going in that direction, you will fall off of that cliff because of the law of gravity. Now, when you meet the bottom at the rocks, you will either be injured or you may die. That is not a directive. That is a descriptive. In other words, because of the law that's in place, if you do this, then this will happen. That is a descriptive. Tithing is like that. It is not tither be cursed. It's that if you tithe, you are now functioning in an ancient principle. But if you do not tithe, then the law comes into place and you have placed yourself under the curse that is attached to not tithing because you've robbed God. All the donuts are God's. And God wants us to be stewards. Therefore, God is saying, you are cursed with a curse if you take what is mine and don't use it properly. It is a descriptive, not a directive. But on the other side of that, when we do tithe, now we receive the blessing of that. Because remember, the descriptive isn't just if you don't tithe, you will put yourself under the curse. Remember, the descriptive goes on and says, if you do tithe, will I not open the windows of heaven for you and pour out a blessing so much so that you can't contain it? And now you're operating in the grace of God. You guys understand that? Clear as mud. It's all good. Last thing for today is this. What does tithing do? Not only does it deliver us from fear of finances and from the bondage of mammon, not only does it now show the priority that God is first, but also, finally, last thing for today is this. The tithe is holy, and it blesses the rest. The tithe is holy, and it blesses the rest. Romans chapter 11, verse number 16 says this, for if the first fruit is holy, the lump is also holy, and if the root is holy, so are the branches. What does holy mean? Holy means dedicated or devoted unto God for a special purpose. Think about it like a telephone line, right? Some of you guys know what a dedicated phone line is. You don't use that phone line for anything else except for what it's dedicated for. How about 911, right? That's a dedicated phone line. That if you use it the wrong way, here's the descriptive, you will go to jail, right? If you want to do prank calls on 911, they are going to find you. They will triangulate where your cell phone is, and they will come and grab you and lock you up for doing that. But if you operate in the right way and use that dedicated phone line for what it's used for, when you have an emergency and you use it properly, what happens? They will send you help. The firemen, the policemen, whatever you need, will show up and take care of your needs. Tithing is the same way. It's dedicated. It's devoted to God. When we use it improperly, we put ourselves under a curse. But when we use it properly, now we get blessed, because if the tithe is holy, then the lump is holy. That means that my 90% is now blessed by God and spends like whatever I needed to spend, because I have the receiving power of God and the grace of God on my finances. I love what Moore writes. He says, in trying to defraud God, we only defraud ourselves. The eagle who robbed the altar set fire to her nest from bringing the burning coal that adhered to the stolen flesh into her nest. So men who retain God's money in their treasuries will find it's a losing possession. No man ever lost by serving God with a whole heart, nor gained by serving him with a half one. We may compromise with conscience for half the price, but God will not endorse the compromise. If we would have God open his treasury, we must open ours. Guys, God owns all the donuts. Let's not steal God's donuts. Let's steward what he's sharing with us. Can you guys say amen to that today? Hallelujah. God is so good. I want to just take a couple more minutes of your time, and then I'll let you go. Okay, so I'm going to ask everybody, please remain seated. Please don't get up and leave during this time. There's a couple leave early sections that if you're serving in a ministry right now, you are dismissed, but everybody else, you are not dismissed. Okay? Stay put. Turn your cell phones off. Okay? Focus in, because God wants to speak to you where you're at right now. Listen, for those of you that got up and left and you're not serving in the ministry, I want you guys to, there's a bench right next to you out there in the breezeways, some tables out there in the foyer. Just sit down. Listen up. God wants to speak to your life because your eternal life is at stake. Remember, we talked about a directive versus a descriptive. Oftentimes, when people think about salvation, they think about heaven. They think about church. They think that church is a bunch of directives. Don't do this, don't do that, do this, don't do that. And one of the directives that a lot of people think about when they think about church is either be a Christian or go to hell. If you're not a Christian, you're going to hell. That's just how it is. Now, that's a directive. But really, when it comes to salvation, let me give you the descriptive. What is God saying? There's only one of two places that we're going to spend eternity. You're either going to go to heaven or you're going to go to hell. But God loves us so much, he didn't want a bunch of robots. He could have created robots to worship him and praise him for all eternity. Billions, trillions, however many he wanted. They could sing better than we could, look better than we could. God could do it. And yet he didn't want a bunch of robots. He wanted a bunch of free will agents, people who loved him in truth, who really loved him, really wanted to be with him. And so God gives us the choice while we're here on the earth to either choose heaven or to choose hell with our life. We get the choice. Now, sometimes people say, well, that's cool because, you know, everybody's going to heaven. Jesus went to the cross and died for us to open up the way for heaven. Now it's wide open. And whatever you want to do, you just do that. And now you get to go to heaven because Jesus loves us. All roads lead to heaven. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. The churches out there and the different religions, they can do whatever they want to do. And somehow, some way, we'll find our way there together. Well, that's really foolish. You know why? Because not all roads lead to heaven. Any more than on the earth, all roads lead to the moon. Just apply the logic to the earth for a second. What if I told you all roads lead to the moon? Just drive around. You'll make it there. You'd say, you're crazy. You can drive around the earth as long as you want, and you'll never make it. And yet, what makes us think that all roads lead to heaven? You know, you can't do whatever you want to do and get there. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. That means we can't get there your way, can't get there my way, can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way or religion's way. No, there's one way we're going to have to get there. In fact, the Bible doesn't describe the road to heaven as wide and expansive and really open. It talks about it as narrow, hard to find. And it says there are few who find it. Let me shine the light on the path for you guys today. Sometimes people think, well, you know what? If we just can be good enough or smart enough or nice enough, if we can attend enough church, maybe if we were raised up as Christians, that we could go to heaven. Maybe if we can quote enough scripture, if we can memorize some scriptures, maybe if we can get involved and help out, sing in a choir, carry a pastor's Bible, make decisions in a church. Maybe if we know enough about God and know God and know who he is, celebrate Christmas and Easter, sing the songs every year of our lives. Maybe we can work our way up and gain good favor with God and get into heaven. But did you know God is not some jolly old Saint Nick in the heavenlies, making a list and checking it twice of who's been naughty and who's been nice? It doesn't work like that. You can't be good enough to get to heaven. You can't attend enough church. You can't memorize enough scripture. Listen, the demons and the devil himself know who Jesus is. They can quote scriptures. You can read that in your Bible, Matthew, the 4th chapter. The devil knows who Jesus is and quotes scriptures. And yet, he's not going to heaven. He's not a Christian. He was cast out because he made a choice. And in the same way in our lives, we can't know enough. Look up at me. You can't have enough head knowledge about who God is, knowing who Jesus is. You can't do enough good. You can't volunteer enough or serve enough or give enough money. Because the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. God's righteousness, God's justice is broken when we sin. And everyone except one who's Jesus has sinned. And we all are deserving of hell because we've rebelled. We've made a choice to rebel against God. But here's the neat thing. Jesus went to the cross and died so that we didn't have to stay in that position. Even though we were already condemned and headed for hell, now Jesus says, I'm laying before you life and death. I'm giving you a choice. And you can choose life. You can choose to go to heaven. Jesus said it like this. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. It's that simple. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They've raked it through the coals. You've seen movies and read books and blogs on the internet about how weird being born again is. Well, listen, this is not about what society says. This is about what the Bible says. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, a little up, little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, remember, we're doing this God's way. Jesus said this. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. You've heard the descriptive. You know that you have a choice before you. And if you want to respond by giving God all of your heart and all of your life, heading for heaven, making that choice today, in a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, want to give God all my life, want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that today, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. And yet the devil's going to try and whisper in your ear right now, don't do this. This is silly. This is crazy. You're going to look weird. What are people going to think? Your flesh is going to try and hold you back. You'll be nervous, anxious, heart pounding out of your chest. Listen, put all that aside. Make the right choice today. Let's choose life. Let's go on with God forever and ever, giving God all of your heart and all of your life. He gave you all of his heart. He gave you all of his life on the cross, beaten, bloody, naked, hung on a tree. Public spectacle. Now, in this safe and friendly church service, will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life? Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching my television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, if you're in the breezeways listening to the sound of my voice, get ready to get your hand up and then come back into the church service right afterwards or tell an usher. If you're watching online, wherever you're at across the nation and around the world, get ready to get your hand up. God sees and God's watching right where you're at. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise your hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Finally, who should raise your hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. Get ready. Here we go. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three. Thank you. There's four up top. There's five up top. Got you. There's six over there. Thank you. God bless you. There's seven. Got you right there. Seven wise people already. Who else today? Seven, eight up top over there. Got you. Eight, nine, ten. Thank you. 11. God bless you. Who else today? 11 wise people, 11, 12 over there, thank you, 13, 14, 15, 16, got all four of you guys right there, you can put your hands down, thank you, 16 wise people, 17 over there, thank you, 18 over there, got you both, you can put your hands down, God bless you guys, who else today, 18, up top, thank you, 19 over there, God bless you, 19, can't you just feel number 20, number 20, you're sitting there wondering if you should do this, oh yeah, you should, let's go for God today, come on, will you give God all of your heart, will you give God all of your life? Where are you at, number 20? Raise it up high. Thank you, 20. Thank you, 21. Now you got me going on. Come on. Who else today? There's 21 wise people. Will you join them? Anybody else? Anybody else? Need to give God all your heart. Need to give God all of your life. 21, 20. Where are you at? You're pointing this direction. All the way up on top. Number 22. Got you up there. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Woo! So cool. All right, front to back, left to right, wherever you're at. If you're in the family rooms and your children raise their hand, maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you should have. Hey, it's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. Get a hold of your cold purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, we're going to change destinies today. No one leave during this time. Very rude. We're trying to get people to come this way. You're going that way. They'll follow you that way. Listen, let's encourage them to come this way. If you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. Let's all stand and you come right now. Get out of your seat, get in the aisle and meet me up front. Come on down. Come on down. Hallelujah. Just give him a hand. This is for you. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Come on down to the front right now. They're still coming. Come on. You can come too. There's room for you here at the altar. Come on down. Come on down. They're coming. They're coming. This is all for you right now. Come on down. Come on down. This is your time. This is your moment. They're still coming. They're still coming. We'll wait for you. We'll wait for you. Come on down. All right. Amen. If you still need to come, while I'm giving some instructions, just make your way up to the front. All right? This is still for you. There's still time. There's still room. God loves you so much. He's encouraging you to come right now. All right? They're still coming. Praise God. Hey, everybody up front, look up here for a second. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Best decision of your entire life right now. Wow. That's awesome. It's awesome. Now listen, right over here to my right, your left, this guy right here waving at you, this is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they going to show me their socks and talk about donuts? Listen, he's not going to do any of that, all right? He's really cool. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart, going to be born again. Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature, talk to you about a program we have here, help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. Okay, it's easy. It's free. I would encourage you to do it, all right? And then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. Just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise as they go today. Hallelujah.